Welcome to the EKG Guy. If this is your first time, I'm glad you're joining us, and welcome back if you're returning. So now we're going to be looking at ventricular fibrillation, or VFib, in our EKG coding reference guide. Okay, and if you don't have access, what you want to do is simply put this link in your URL or in your search bar, put your email address in, click submit, you'll get an email, and in your email you'll have a link, and from that link you'll click it, and you'll have access to the reference guide. We're in part two. We've gone through part one, where we looked at normal EKGs. We looked at atrial enlargement. Well, now we went through rhythms. We went through sinus rhythms, atrial rhythms, AV junctional, and we're now finishing up our ventricular rhythms before we get into conduction blocks at the AV node. So in rhythms, what you want to do is hit this drop down and go find ventricular fibrillation, or VFib. And if you're returning, you can again put your email address in and click submit, and you'll bypass that all the email setup. That's just for the initial one. Now, if you're interested in our course and all our books and other lectures, you can simply go to www.ekg.md. Okay, and you can click on our course and see what we have to offer there. A lot more that's available. All right, so let's get started. So ventricular fibrillation, what is this? Well, this is chaotic ventricular depolarization that's occurring without any synchronized ventricular contractions. And as a result, there's no cardiac output, and this could result in sudden cardiac death without any advanced life support. What we see on the EKG are irregular deflections of varying amplitude without any discernible waveforms. And if you have prolonged ventricular fibrillation, this could result in progressive loss of energy stores. It can result, therefore, in a loss of waveform amplitude. And that's why we have different forms where we can go from this VFib and eventually into asystole, which is simply a flat line, okay, on the EKG. So what we see here are these chaotic, rapid, irregular waveforms, and that's simply this here, okay, all these waveforms that we see. Remember, this here is actually VTAC going into ventricular fibrillation, okay, and you'll notice if it continues, then eventually, without any life support, can go into asystole, or that flat line. Okay, so notice that ventricular tachycardia has more of a regular shape to it, and those complexes, and then all this fibrillatory waves that we see here. Okay, remember, when we go to from left to right on the standard 12-lead EKG, we're going from 0 seconds, so time 0 seconds, to time 10 seconds, all right? Therefore, all these things here and everything above and below is occurring at the same time. If you imagine this 3 seconds into it, everything here is occurring at the same time. That's what we call a temporal relationship of the EKG. All right, so let's just review a few more things. So again, ventricular fibrillation. What are some of the mechanisms that we can see with it? Well, it's not really fully understood what the mechanism is, but it's likely a multiple wavelet, or there's something called mother roots rotors that you may have heard of. And the other thing I want to note is that from VT, we go into this, and notice that the amplitude here versus the amplitude in some areas here. Okay, now, and if the amplitude is greater than 3 millimeters, or at least 3 millimeters, we call that coarse ventricular fibrillation. If it is less than that, okay, so less than 3 millimeters, then we call this fine VFib. Okay, these are just nuances, obviously won't change much of the management with the patient, but just some things to know. All right, so what causes it? So myocardial ischemia or infarctioning causes, any cardiomyopathies can result in it, channelopathies, so any problems with the sodium or maybe potassium channels, as we see in some of these inherited disorders, aortic stenosis or dissection, myocarditis can result in it, cardiac tamponade, blunt trauma, tension pneumothorax, pulmonary embolism. You can have what we see in that if we have a prolonged QT, so if you have an increase in the QT interval, okay, you can have what's called an R on T phenomenon, and this can result in torsades de pointes. Okay, or twisting on the points, and then eventually into VFib, and maybe into asystole. Okay, so we said trauma can cause this for sure. Sepsis, even hypothermia. So why is this clinically significant? Well, this is actually a fatal arrhythmia without any immediate life support. So you really have to shock these patients, okay, to get them out of this rhythm, because this is certainly a fatal rhythm. Now, one thing to note is if you see this rhythm, make sure you see the patient and that it's not artifact, okay? Oftentimes we'll see this maybe on a monitor when we're not even in the room, you know, and there may be an alert that there's ventricular fibrillation and it's all artifact. So those are key things to keep in mind when using this more clinically. So again, we obviously don't have any P waves or PR intervals. There's no defined complexes. This is just fibrillation of, as the name implies, of the ventricles. Okay, so again, just to recap, what we see here are these irregular deflections of varying amplitude, as we're seeing in all these leads, okay, without any discernible waveform. So no P wave, no QRS complex, no T wave. We see a little bit of VT, ventricular tachycardia, in the beginning of this lead, but then that goes into ventricular fibrillation. Remember, this is chaotic ventricular depolarizations. There's no synchronized ventricular contractions, therefore no cardiac output, and again can be fatal without any advanced life support. If this goes on for some time, this progressively decreases and depletes any energy stores. We can get a decrease in amplitude, maybe from the coarse to the fine ventricular fibrillation. Okay, and eventually have asystole, that flat line. All right, mechanistically still not fully understood. There's many different proposed mechanisms, but obviously doesn't change the way we manage our patients. And again, this is fatal without immediate advanced life support. Well, that's the end of this lecture. I hope you learned something. Now, just to keep you in mind of our course material that we have available. So again, if you go to our website, www.ekg.md, okay, so this is our website. And what you'll notice is that if you go to the EKG course here, okay, you'll find stuff that's separate. So notice that we have a number of topics, practice material, lectures, a way for you to contribute. And this is the course here. Over here. So you'll notice we have over 300 videos or so, and that's more on YouTube. There's another 100, more than 100, about 200 videos that are available with the course. So those are separate videos, and this course is really designed to take you from a beginner to advanced interpreter. Okay, so completely separate from what you're getting online for free. Okay, these are course material that comes with it. So notice that you have a book. Okay, and then you also have the pocket guide available, so you can choose which format. They are the same thing, both these book and the pocket guide, different formats. I really like this small one because you can keep it in your white coat if you're in the clinic or in your pocket, and it's really available on the go. Now with the book, you also get videos. So notice these are the videos, okay? And these are a video for every single page in that book. So it's over 30 hours of video. Now there's a number of practice material that I continue to upload there. Okay, we'll have practice questions coming soon. So all of that's available. Again, this is separate from all the free material that you get already. Okay, so this is more high yield stuff. This is what we use to teach our technicians here and our students here at Mayo Clinic. And it's used now among many institutions. So use check that out. Now, what it also includes are calipers. So yes, you get calipers with this course, okay? I don't know anyone else that offers that, but you do get calipers. I think they're very helpful, and they can, you know, if you know how to use them correctly, can help to identify different arrhythmias that are going on, okay? And then you also get our pocket EKG reference. Okay, this was something we've put together as we were developing course for the fellows, and this is really nice. It has every code, as you saw earlier, laid out there. Very small pocket guide available. I had help with my colleague, Dr. Peter Noseworthy, who's the head of the EKG lab here at Mayo Clinic, in editing it. So this is something that we use, and we found very helpful. So go to the EKG course, you'll see examples of lectures, okay, why we developed this, okay? A lot of it came about from myself struggling with learning EKGs, having a father that was an interventional cardiologist and, you know, still struggling. So my struggle is a struggle that I don't want you to have in learning them, okay? You can read all those introductory books, but honestly, they are not enough, okay? And you find yourself using other resources, which is part of the learning process. I wanted to expedite that process for you and make it less inefficient in pretty much what I struggled with going and learning through EKG. So again, from beginner to advanced level with this course, you get the book, the calipers, the coding reference, video access, okay? And now we're offering 25% off. 25% off, put that code in on checkout and you'll have yourself 25% off that will even, it's pretty much covers the cost of what we use to print the material. So we don't really make much off it. It's more to help our learners grow and really be able to contribute to patient care. That's why we do this and we love doing it. So thank you so much for your support. If you have any questions, just leave them below and we're happy to answer them. All right, have a great day.